All right, friends, I have a really important question to ask you guys. And my question is this. Aw, that was supposed to be the best transition ever. Who's up there? Joey, I blame you. My question is this. What do you guys think about when you picture the future? So are you living on a space station? In the future, maybe you can teleport to all of the places you want to go. So you have to take like classes on like teleportation for beginners. Or maybe do you think ChatGPT will take over the future and it will just be running the world? What do you think? Okay, turn to your neighbor and I want you to share real quick. What do you think about when you picture the future? So what I really want to happen in the future is I really want them to invent this thing. My brother and I talk about this all the time. When we're watching like food shows, so like when you're watching the Great British Bake Off, I want them to invent something to where whenever you're watching a show with food in it, you can get a little sample of whatever they're making on there so that you could like try a little sample of it. Wouldn't that be the best invention ever? I think that'd be so cool. What is it? Smell-o-vision! I think we're onto something, guys. Oh, that would be really cool. All right. Oh. Yeah. That'd be cool. All right, so even if we don't consciously realize it, we spend a lot of time thinking about the future. We wonder what we're gonna be doing tomorrow, or if maybe your celebrity crush will ever notice us. Like, what if they just like come in through the door and they're like, you're the love of my life? What if? But guys, as children, like what you guys were saying, thinking about the future felt fun and exciting, right? Because we wanted to be astronauts or fighter pilots. But now, thinking and speaking of the future can kind of feel like a lot, especially when it comes to things that can stress us all out, right? So for the most part, the future is unknown. Yes, there's a couple of circumstances to where we could pretty much guess what's gonna happen, but for the most part, none of us actually know exactly what the future will bring us. And that could be really scary. And we can feel some stress maybe over our immediate future. So things that are happening like right now. So our minds might worry about things like what the next year of our school year or our next semester is gonna look like. Maybe if we'll ever have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, or if that person that likes us is ever gonna notice us. Maybe it's not the celebrity crush. Maybe it's just our regular crush. What our parents are gonna say about the grade that we got in our class. Maybe we're thinking about if we're going to score the next goal at our game, or if we're going to make a win at our next game, you know? But guys, there's also bigger stuff that we worry about, more long-term stresses. And so maybe we don't stress about stuff in the moment, but for some of you, you feel stressed about things that you want in your life to change. So you have things you hope will be different than they are now. So maybe some bigger stuff, like your home life, really isn't that great. And so you wonder if things will ever change and if you're ever gonna be able to escape it. Maybe you don't have a lot of friends right now. Like me, I didn't have a lot of friends for a period of time in my life. And so I was always afraid that I would never find people who accepted and understood and liked me for who I was. Maybe you just learn or process things differently than a lot of your other peers. And so you wonder if it's ever going to get any easier in school or in social situations. And it's really hard, right? Whatever it is that you might be nervous about in the future because you're worried that you don't want it to change, or you're maybe worried about the exact opposite. Maybe things are going really great. So maybe your stress about the future is that you don't want things to change. You love the way your life looks like right now. You're happy with your family, your friends. You're happy with the grades you have at school, the classes that you have. You're happy on your team or whatever sport or extracurricular you're involved in. And when you think about the future, you get stressed because by those thoughts, because you don't want things to change. It won't always be the same in the future, so you're worried about that. And here's the thing. Every single day, we get to enjoy this thing called life. and we get to wake up just a tiny bit older and move one day after the other and after the other and after the other. And so what happens with this life is there's always going to be a future ahead of us, right? And in this future, really great things can come. We can have really great things happen to us in this future. And also in this future, we can have stuff that will be really difficult that's coming our way. And so I don't know about you, but just thinking about the unknown of whether my immediate or long-term future is going to be good or bad or somewhere in between, or if there's going to be something that completely blows up my life, it's stressful, right? It's a lot. So what we're talking about, and the question that I really want to for us to discuss tonight, is how are we supposed to face a future that we really don't actually have any control over? How do we stay stress-free in the moment when we have no idea what this future is going to look like? Maybe tomorrow, the next day, or the day after that. And so there's a really incredible experience recorded in the Bible that's about a couple of guys who are in a situation to where they did not have any control over what was happening to them. And I think we could learn a lot about what by watching the way that they handled the stress that was brought to their attention and how they navigated their way through it. And so it's also a really just crazy fun story to listen to. It's a really ridiculous. So let me tell you about this story about these two men called Paul and Silas. You guys say Paul?
Paul.
You guys say Silas?
Silas.
Amazing. So there is these two men called Paul and Silas. They were buddies. They had placed their faith in Jesus, and they dedicated their lives to traveling from city to city by telling other people the good news about God and the good news that Jesus had just brought after his life, his ministry, his death, and his resurrection. So it was right after Jesus died and resurrected, and this new church was starting, and they were traveling around making this church. It was a really big thing. And so their journey is recorded in the New Testament in a book called Acts. So Acts is all about the start of the early church here. And so during their ministry, when Paul and Silas were traveling from town to town on their way to a town called Philippi, which what we know today as modern day Greece. So if you know anywhere where Greece is, or if you're bad at geography like me, you're like, cool, I know what Greece is. I don't know where it is. But that's besides the fact. They come across this girl who was owned by some guys who made some money off of her because she was possessed by a spirit. So the Bible says that she was possessed by a spirit that gave her the ability to predict the future. Isn't that crazy? It's wackadoodles. So these guys were basically making money off of her, people paying her to tell them their fortune. It's kind of like the, like, she's like wearing that crazy thing and she's like with a crystal ball, she's a fortune teller. Ooh. So she was enslaved by bad men. She was enslaved by the spirit. So you can imagine she was pretty miserable, right? And so when Paul and Silas came upon her, she was traveling with them for a couple of days. And finally, Paul got so fed up with the spirit that he was like, you know what? I need to do something about this. So Paul prayed in Jesus' name to set her free from the spirit, and God answered that prayer, and she was set free. Can you imagine how excited she was to finally be free from that? And also, can you imagine that those people that owned her were pretty mad that they got their moneymaker taken away, right? They couldn't make any money by her telling fortunes because the spirit wasn't there anymore. So frustrating. So you know what these men did? These mean men beat up Paul and sent them to jail. Paul and Silas were in jail, so they had been beaten and taken away, and they were thrown into prison. Now, guys, this wasn't any old prison here. They were put in the innermost cell with their feet chained. So this is going to be really important later in the story. So just remember that they were the furthest into the jail. Their feet were chained to the wall. So a guard stood watch over them day and night, so they had no way of escaping. So you can imagine, guys, talk about having zero control out of a situation, having no idea what's going to happen to you in the nearest future, right? In a super stressful situation, what is it that Paul and Silas does? So this is the first scripture we're going to look at tonight. So it's the first half of what our main scripture is. So it says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying. Now, guys, even if you're really not sure if you believe in God or not, I feel like all of us have been in a moment kind of like this, to where we're super stressed out. We have no idea what's going on. We don't know if we're going to die or not. And so we're like, God, please just get us out of this situation, right? We've all made a desperate prayer like that. Like, be like, God, if you help me ace this test, I will do the dishes for a month, right? We've all made that desperate prayer, right? I've made that desperate prayer before. But what we see here, I think Paul and Silas were praying about something a little bit different. They weren't praying out of desperation. Guys, they were praying about hope. And why I know that is because of what the rest of this scripture says. So we're going to pull up the next scripture here. So this is the same scripture, but expanded. So it says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. So hymns, if you don't know what a hymn is, it's basically a really cool, like, kind of like a worship song, except it's more old-fashioned, where they have specific words and verses and stuff like that. It's what you'd sing up in traditional, basically. So they were singing hymns, and they were praying and praising God. And so these men, they were chained up. They were beaten. And their future was filled with so much unknown. And yet, in the middle of their biggest insecurities, they chose joy. In that super stressful moment, they turned their attention towards praise and prayer. So guys, as you can see, Paul and Silas had little to no control over the situation that they were in, and even less control about what their future had in store for them, right? But they had complete control over what their attitude chose. Instead of choosing stress or fear or hopelessness, they instead chose joy. They chose to turn to God, who they trusted with their present and their future. And this is what we could take away from that, guys. Guys, when the future seems like too much, joy is always a choice. And what's crazy is that this isn't even the end of the story. This is like the middle, like it's kind of like when you're watching a play, it's like the like big crazy climax to get you to like, what is the halftime play of a play? Intermission, yeah, it gets you to intermission. So we're at intermission now, guys, and we're jumping back into act two of our play. So right in the middle of Paul and Silas singing and praising and worshiping to God in the middle of a jail, which is so crazy, there was an earthquake that shook the entire jail. So there's this earthquake that's happening. And then the even crazier part is this earthquake inadvertently makes all of the walls fall down, the doors all open, and the chains fall off of them, right? So you'd think, Paul and Silas set free, amazing. And that's not what happens. Guys, just like that. Do you remember how I said that there was this jailer that stood over them day and night, right? So can you imagine this jailer, that's this prison guy that's sitting there making sure, the guard is sitting there making sure that no one escapes. That's his only duty in life, is to make sure that those prisoners stay there. And then he just watches all the doors open, the walls crumble, and the chains get broken away. I can imagine that he found himself really, really worried about his circumstances, right? He must have been sitting there thinking, my gosh, I am going to be killed over this because all of these prisoners probably have already found their way out. So just as he was about to be in the worst possible moment of his life and he's crying and he's so upset, Paul shouts out and he says, no, whatever your name is, let's call him Joe. No, Joe, the prison guard, we're still here. And so you can imagine that they were so amazed by the fact that Paul and Silas didn't go anywhere. How they carried themselves, how they handled this situation, that this guard, this Joe guy, fell down in front of them and asked what he must do to be saved. So he saw what their faith did, and he was like, I need a faith that looks like that. And so right there in that moment, that very night, he was saved, and he now is a believer of Christ. All because of the way that he saw Paul and Saul respond to their uncertain circumstances. And so this is the other lesson that we can learn from Paul and Silas. Not Paul and Saul, Paul and Silas. when you choose joy, when you're in an uncertain circumstance and you choose joy, you never know how it may affect and inspire others. You never know what that joy might do for the person sitting next to you. And now, guys, I don't want to say that joy just takes away all of our worries when we choose joy. It doesn't take away those uncertainties. But I do think that it can also help us navigate the stress when we feel that we feel in these unknown circumstances. And it doesn't mean also, guys, I don't want you to pretend to put on a smile and pretend to be okay. That's not what choosing joy means. I'm not saying to pretend to smile and pretend to be okay when you're not, to pretend to be fine when you're not okay. Sometimes choosing joy doesn't feel possible. And so sometimes in those circumstances, we might need to get some people, talk to some people, get somebody to help us to learn how to choose joy. Whether that is a trusted adult like your parent, a small group leader, a counselor at school, I see a therapist every other week to help me see, choose joy because it's really hard for me. I have friends that have to take medication because their anxiety or their depression makes it really hard for them to choose joy, and so they need medication to be able to help with that. Just because maybe some of us, it's easier for some of us to choose joy in a stressful situation than others, doesn't mean that there's not tools to be able to help with that. So choosing joy doesn't mean pretending like everything's fine, but it does mean finding hope in the fact that God is with you during every single step in that future. That is our hope that we could take away from this, is that God is never gonna leave us alone in this uncertainty. And so in light of all of this, here's what I'd like for you to do to start choosing joy. So one, I think it's really important that we identify what we're worried about. So we can't fix anything until we know what the problem is, right? So is there something that you feel like you have no control over? Something that feels like a lot? And be honest with yourself. Be honest with what's stressing you out. Identify it to yourself. Identify it with a friend. Identify it with someone you trust, and identify it to God. And then ask these next two questions. So what, if anything, can I actually control about this situation? So is there anything that you can do? Are there some simple steps that you could take to at least help the situation get a little bit better? So maybe you can't control the fact about your parents fighting, but you have a really great friend that when you're at school, you can be able to rely on them to be able to help talk with you about stuff. So you can choose to go and talk to that person to choose joy in that way. Maybe you're having a really hard time in school, and so you could choose joy by choosing to take the extra step to go and see a tutor, to go and ask your teacher for help. And then the third question, or the third thing that I want you to do, is ask this: how can I choose joy in this situation? So what would it look like for you to trust God, put your hope in God, and choose joy right now, even before you know what's going to happen in the future, even before the dust settles and you know what's going to happen? So friends, I'm not saying that it's going to be easy for us to choose joy. Not all of us are able to do that the same way. It's going to look different for everybody. But I do know that it's possible to choose joy in the faces of an uncertain future, just like what Paul and Silas did. And so as you guys are heading to small groups and as we're praying out, I want you to reflect on this question. What is one way that I can choose joy this week?